This recording is protected by copyright. No part may be reproduced without the prior permission of the University of South Australia.
Okay, good morning, everybody, and may I just begin by thanking Professor Elliott very much indeed for the welcome to Adelaide for this National Asylum Summit. It's a very great privilege and honour to be asked to present this keynote address this morning. As you'll have seen, I've chosen the title of a Beatles song for the title of my presentation. I hope you remember the song. Some of you are old enough to remember it. It was released in 1969, I checked this morning. I must admit I remember it quite well. So the main title of my presentation is Get Back to Where You Once Belonged, and I'll explain in a couple of minutes why I've chosen to give my presentation that title. And then, as you'll see from this first slide, my subtitle this morning is A Global Perspective on Migration, Asylum and Refugee Protection. And I guess I'd like to stress the fact that this really will be a global perspective. At one or two points in the presentation, I'll make specific reference to Australia, but in general, my analysis will be at the global level. Hopefully, that will provide a suitable backdrop for the more specific discussion of Australian refugee and asylum policy in the forthcoming sessions of this National Asylum Summit. Okay, let me just very quickly give you a sense of where I'm coming from and what I'm going to say in the next 25 or 30 minutes, and I'll just read out what's on this first slide. We live in and benefit from an increasingly mobile and globalized world. But in the public and political discourse of the global north, and of course Australia is part of the global north, there seems to be a growing conviction that refugees and asylum seekers from other parts of the world should be either contained within or induced to return to their places of origin. And the presentation I'll be giving this morning provides an analysis of and proposes an alternative to this essentially negative perspective on the institution of asylum. Okay, let me start by making some reference to some recent refugee crises in developing and middle-income countries of the world. Professor Elliott just made reference to this new UNHCR publication. It came out about 10 days ago, I think. Received quite a lot of publicity in the international press for the very fact that he mentioned, for the very reason he mentioned, that it really has drawn the international community's attention to the growing scale and scope of the international displacement crisis. What I want to do for the first part of my presentation is just make reference to some of the specific new refugee emergencies that UNHCR has had to respond to. Let's start then by going back 3 years to 2010-2011, the armed conflict, the human rights violations that were taking place in Cote d'Ivoire in West Africa led to a generation of at least 100,000 new refugees, most of them going to the neighbouring countries of Liberia, Ghana, and to a lesser extent other countries in the West Africa region. That was very quickly followed by the emergency in Somalia in 2011, which generated at least 300,000 new refugees as a result of armed conflict and human rights violations in the central and southern parts of the country, coupled with a very serious drought and famine. And this drove nearly 300,000 people to seek refuge, primarily in Kenya and in Ethiopia. And this particular slide shows new refugees arriving in Kenya on their way to the Dadaab refugee camp, which, as many of you will know, is the largest camp in the world with at least 500,000 inhabitants at the moment. Following hard on the heels of the Somalia crisis, we were obliged to respond to the crisis in Mali, which generated in the region of 150,000 new refugees, most of them going to Mauritania and Burkina Faso. Quite an unusual refugee influx. As you'll see from this particular picture, it involved a nomadic population, and UNHCR is not particularly used to dealing with nomadic populations, but it also involved a refugee population that brought a very large number of animals with them. So this was quite an interesting combination for UNHCR to have to deal with, a nomadic refugee group with large numbers of animals. We tried putting them in a camp and it didn't work very well. An ongoing emergency which started in 2012, which is still going on today, the crisis in the Blue Nile and South Kordofan regions of Sudan, driving at least 200,000 people to cross the border into the relatively newly established state of South Sudan. Again, a particularly complex operation from UNHCR in terms of the logistics of actually providing assistance to people in such a remote and difficult area, an area indeed where there's almost no infrastructure to speak of. And then, to bring the story up to date, the 2013, the current crisis in Syria, which so far has generated at least 1.5 million new refugees. The picture you'll see here is a refugee camp established in Turkey by the Turkish Red Crescent Society. But of course, there are also very, very large numbers of new Syrian refugees in the neighboring countries of Jordan, Lebanon, and Iraq. And I had the privilege of visiting all three countries just a couple of weeks ago, and I certainly reached two very clear conclusions from that visit. Firstly, there's absolutely no end to the crisis, and people continue to cross borders, and it seems very, very likely that large numbers of people, once they get the opportunity to leave Syria, will do so and will take refuge in neighboring states. And my second conclusion is that these countries, Jordan, Lebanon, Iraq, and Turkey, are now under incredible amount of pressure on their society, their economy, their infrastructure, their environment. And Lebanon particularly, I would say, has almost reached breaking point in that respect. And this is a very worrying situation confronting UNHCR at the moment. Now, I want to turn your attention away from the developing and middle-income countries of the world to look at asylum seekers in the developed world, in the industrialized states, or as we sometimes call it, the global north. And I think here you'll see the figures show a somewhat different story. Let's take a look at this first graph. It was produced by UNHCR. You'll find a copy of it in the new Global Trends report. If you look closely at the bar chart here, you'll see that the numbers of asylum seekers making their way to 44 industrialized states peaked in the early 1990s, particularly with the crisis in the Balkans. But after that, between 92 and 96 or 98, a steady decline in the number. A slight rise again in around the year 2000. But since the year 2000, the numbers of asylum seekers making their way to the industrialized states has initially reduced quite significantly. There's been a slight rise in the last two or three years, but in general, the long-term trend of asylum seekers arriving in the industrialized states is certainly quite sharply down. So if you look at the very last bar on that chart, which is 2012, and compare it with 1992, you'll see that there's been a very significant decrease in the number of asylum seekers reaching the developed world. Maybe in 2012, around half of the number that arrived in 1992. I think a very clear downward trend in numbers. Let's look at a slide produced by the Australian government, which compares the OECD countries as a whole with Australia. And again, you'll see quite a similar pattern that has affected both Australia but also the other OECD countries. Quite a significant kind of peak in asylum applications in 2000. Then from 2000 onwards to around 2007, 2008, a fairly steep decline in numbers. And then in the past few years, definitely a rise in numbers, but I would suggest quite a modest rise. And again, you'll see where we've ended up in 2011 on the last year indicated on this chart, significantly smaller number of asylum seekers arriving when compared to the peak year of 2000. And now let's look at a third chart, also produced by the Australian government, which will be of particular interest to the Australians gathered here today, which is the whole issue of maritime arrivals. And this chart shows the number of maritime arrivals in a number of different countries around the world. On the far left, you'll see Australia. Small numbers, I would argue, overall, but clearly there has been an increase in the most recent year, indicated here, 2012. When we look at people going to Greece from Turkey and to going to Spain from West Africa and North Africa, you'll see a steady decline in the numbers compared to the numbers going from North Africa to Italy, where there's been a significant increase. But I would suggest that it's the chart on the far right of this table which is the most interesting one, because this looks at the number of boat arrivals from Somalia in Yemen in the Middle East. And as you'll see, there's been a very, very significant increase in numbers of people going by boat to Somalia, much, much higher than the increase in numbers coming here to Australia. In general, you can see vastly greater numbers of people making their way by boat to Yemen than are making their way by boat to countries in the global north. So you'll see from that right-hand side chart, in 2012, over 100,000 boat arrivals to Yemen alone, almost as much as all of the industrialized states put together. So I want to summarize the information that I've just presented. And my summary would be as follows. While recent years have witnessed a succession of large-scale refugee crises in the developing world, the industrialized states, including Australia, I would suggest, have recorded only a very modest increase in the number of asylum applications that they have received in the same period. So it's this contrast I want to draw your attention to. Vast new refugee movements in the developing world, but relatively modest increase of asylum seekers arriving in the industrialized states. And I want to here make a suggestion to set the backdrop for the rest of my analysis. And I want to suggest that these contrasting trends, that is, massive displacement in the developing world, but only a modest increase in numbers of asylum seekers in the industrialized states, I'd like to suggest that these contrasting trends are particularly surprising in view of the many factors that might be expected to drive and facilitate the irregular movement of people from one region of the world to another. And if you look at a lot of the recent literature on international migration, and on the irregular movements of people, some of that literature I've contributed to myself, that literature tends to point out that there are a number of factors driving and facilitating the interregional and irregular movement of people from one part of the world to another. What are they? Well, here on the slide I've listed five or six key issues which I think are pertinent in the respect. Firstly, it's very clear from the evidence we've collected in UNHCR that conditions in many long-term refugee camps are declining and deteriorating. People are actually living in worse conditions at a lower standard of living now than they were 5, 10, or even 15 years ago. And the fact that conditions in long-term camps are declining might be expected to drive people to seek opportunities elsewhere in the world to get out of their camps and to try and move to other regions of the world. A second very marked phenomenon we've seen in the past few years is that refugee populations are becoming increasingly urbanized. In fact, most of the world's refugees today do not live in refugee camps, as is often assumed, but have actually made their way to urban areas. And this very much mirrors the general urbanization of the global population. We now live in a world where most of the people and most of the world's refugees live in urban areas. And when people move to urban areas, then a number of things happen. They get much better access to information about travel opportunities and communications networks, which might allow them or facilitate their movement to other parts of the world. When people move to urban areas, they become part of very extensive and global diasporic networks, so they have better information, again, about what is happening in other parts of the world and what the opportunities there might be. They have better access to remittances sent by refugees and compatriots who have managed to make their way to the industrialized states and who have managed to find work there. And I think a little known factor, although remittances are often seen in totally positive terms by many states and development agencies, it's also, I would suggest, quite clear that remittances are one of the major factors driving irregular movements of people, because these days, to get out of your own country and to move to another part of the world, almost inevitably, you have to make use of the services of smugglers and other elements of the so-called migration industry, such as people who can provide you with false documents and false visas, for example. And remittances, I would argue, are one of the principal means whereby people who want to move in an irregular manner from one part of the world to another are able to pay smugglers and are able to buy the kind of documents they need to escape the kind of border controls that have been erected in recent years. So what I'd like to suggest is there's a kind of a missing link. On the one hand, you might expect that some of these new refugees that these crises in the developing world are creating would be trying to move further afield to countries such as Australia, to Europe, to North America, for example. But in fact, again, if we look at the numbers are actually rather modest in their increase. They're certainly not proportionate to the growing number of refugees in the world. And I'd like to suggest this morning that the reason why the rise in the number of asylum applications in the industrialised states has been so modest is largely as a result of the enforcement and deterrence measures that states have been introducing in recent years. And I think most of these enforcement and deterrence measures are quite familiar to you, and of course a number of them are particularly associated with the country we're here today in Australia. Let me just run very quickly through some of the kind of suite of deterrence and enforcement measures that states around the world have been introducing in recent years. Firstly, the whole question of interceptions of pushbacks. You may remember a few years ago, for example, Italy pushing boats back to Libya, which evoked quite a hostile reaction from the High Commissioner for Refugees, who saw this as a major violation of human rights and understandings with the government of Italy. And also, of course, it's been suggested in more recent times by politicians in this country that pushing back boats to Australia and from Australia to Indonesia might be one way of dealing with the so-called asylum crisis in this country. A second approach, which involves, I would suggest, enforcement and deterrence, has been the whole idea of transferring new arrivals to other places. You'll all remember, I'm sure, the abortive Malaysia deal that took place not too long ago here. And then the whole idea of offshore processing. Of course, this is particularly associated with Australia, with the transfer of asylum seekers to Manus Island and Nauru. But it's also a model which I think has become quite attractive to other states around the world. And certainly in my own country, the UK government has looked quite extensively into the options for offshore processing of asylum seekers. There's been, I would suggest, quite an expansion of the militarization of border controls. Perhaps the best example we see of this is in the Mediterranean region, with the European coordinating border agency Frontex now running extensive operations in order to identify people arriving in Europe by boat or by land before they actually manage to touch foot in EU territory. And of course, there's been a very significant investment in recent years in anti-smuggling operations, in the use of new technologies for surveillance, and in the use of detention. Just to give you one example of detention, I was in Malta not so long ago and came across a group of Nigerians, very unlucky people. They'd been working in Libya. During the crisis in Libya, they were put into detention for not any clear reason other than the fact that they came from sub-Saharan Africa. After Gaddafi was removed from power, they were released from the prison but forced to go on a boat that was pushed off from the coast on its way to Italy. During their voyage across the Mediterranean, they were picked up by the Maltese Navy, taken to the Maltese mainland, and then charged with irregular entry to Malta. Now, how do you get charged with irregular entry to a country that you weren't even trying to go to? I don't know. But these poor Nigerian guys that we met were stuck in detention for 18 months before they had a chance of being released. And this is clearly a policy of deterrence which is being imposed by the authorities in Malta. And then finally, something which I think you'll be more familiar with than I am here in Australia, the whole notion of using dissuasive information campaigns to try and deter the arrival of new asylum seekers by stressing the dangers involved in the journey and the difficulty of the conditions that people will confront once they arrive in their intended destination. So my general argument is that we have to take into account this whole suite of enforcement and deterrence measures if we are to understand and explain why the number of asylum applications received in the industrialized states has risen to such a modest extent in the past 4 or 5 years. Now, for the rest of my presentation, I want to focus on three particular questions. Firstly, I want to ask, why has this enforcement and deterrence agenda become so dominant? And again, I'm not just talking about Australia, I'm talking on a global basis in the industrialized states. Why has the enforcement and deterrence agenda become so dominant? Secondly, I'd like to ask a question, what have been the consequences of this enforcement and deterrence agenda for refugee protection and the rights of refugees? And then thirdly, to conclude the presentation, I'd like to ask whether alternative and better approaches can be found to the issue of refugee movements and asylum, a better approach than the enforcement and deterrence agenda, which has become so dominant on a global basis today. So let me turn immediately to the first of those three questions. Why is this agenda so dominant? Why is asylum under pressure throughout the industrialized states? And I'd like to suggest a number of reasons, and I don't think any of these will come as much of a surprise to you. Firstly, the whole issue of sovereignty and security, which was discussed to some extent after the lecture last night, has become a very dominant one in the post-9/11 world. And we've now reached what I consider to be a rather kind of ironic or paradoxical situation, where the so-called war on terror is also turning into a war on asylum seekers. Slightly ironic in the sense that actually many of the asylum seekers are trying to escape from terror themselves. So the whole focus on state sovereignty and state security, I think, has been a primary driver of this new enforcement and deterrence agenda. I think it's also linked to economic trends of the last 10 or 15 years. I think during the long economic boom, people generally in the industrialized states became more acquisitive, more individualistic, and perhaps less prone to consider the needs of people coming from war-torn countries where human rights violations are taking place. But I think that's actually been exacerbated by the economic downturn of the past 4 or 5 years. I think it's left people fearful for their future and, again, unreceptive to people coming to their countries from other parts of the world. I'd like to suggest that politicians and the media have played a major role in driving the deterrence and enforcement agenda that I've just explained. Politicians in their desperation to gain votes and the media in their desperation to sell newspapers have certainly made very acute use of the whole asylum issue to, I think, raise public concerns, even panic, even frenzy in some particular instances. We see this very much in my own country, the United Kingdom, where the right-wing press has definitely been pursuing a very systematic anti-asylum and anti-refugee agenda. One of my favourite headlines was "Asylum Threat to House Prices," which I thought was a great one. It just kind of combines all the British preoccupations in one little sentence. I would say that the agenda is also being driven by public perceptions and misperceptions, many misperceptions about the numbers. I think if you took a poll in any of the industrialized states, the man on the street, the woman on the street would give you estimates of asylum seeker arrivals, which are way, way higher than they are actually in fact. I think there's been a lot of misperceptions about the motivations of asylum seekers, the whole notion that many of them are actually economic migrants or so-called bogus asylum seekers. And then the whole perception that in some kind of undefined way, asylum seekers have both criminal connections, perhaps through the use of smuggling networks, but also the perception that some refugee groups, for example, the Somalis, also have terrorist connections. And then finally, I'd like to suggest that this agenda has been driven to some extent by concerns over the whole question of the integration and exclusion of asylum seekers, refugees, and other migrants in the industrialized states. I think there's a growing perception that in some, if not all cases, the integration process has not gone particularly well. And in a context where it's considered that refugees and asylum seekers and migrants are not integrating well, inevitably the question arises as to why should we accept more and just make the situation even more difficult. In my own country, there's, I think, quite an interesting trend going on, which is there seems to be a growing convergence between those on the political left and those on the political right on this issue. And both left and right are arguing that one of the reasons why asylum seeker numbers have to be curtailed is because we've not been able to integrate existing refugee and asylum seeker populations. I'd be very interested to hear whether any similar kind of a process is taking place here in Australia. So that's one of the reasons, some of the reasons I would consider that asylum is under pressure and that this deterrence and enforcement agenda has become so dominant. My second question is, what have been the consequences of this current approach, and what have they been the consequences of this approach, particularly for refugee protection? And I'm not going to explain any of these points in any great depth. I'll just run through them quickly in the interest of time. But I believe that the pursuit of this deterrence and enforcement agenda has undermined and compromised refugee protection principles, such as the principle of non-refoulement, for example, such as the principle that asylum seekers should only be detained in very specific and exceptional cases. I believe that there's been a political race to the bottom with politicians trying to outdo each other in the extent to which they make negative statements about asylum seekers and refugees. And I think this has led to one very unfortunate outcome, which is a very wide degree of negativity towards people who are in need of international protection and who have been recognised as refugees through national refugee status determination processes. And I think that's probably one of the most disturbing consequences of the deterrence and enforcement agenda, that even genuine refugees are looked on with a great deal of suspicion. We see this phrase not only in this country but elsewhere in the world about smashing the smugglers, and I would argue that perhaps one of the consequences of the current approach to refugee and asylum has not been to smash the smugglers. In fact, the smugglers seem to be doing quite well. In fact, it could even be argued that the enforcement measures that have been introduced in recent years have actually helped to boost the business of the smugglers and have certainly increased the level of fees which they are able to charge people wishing to move in an irregular manner from one part of the country to another. I don't think I need to go into the human and social cost of the current approach. I think particularly in the Australian context, this is very well known. And just this morning over breakfast, I saw this headline from one of the daily newspapers here. The inquiry into one asylum-seeking vessel cries for help was just refugee patter. There was a complete disbelief that these people could actually be at risk on the high seas, and they were left, most of them, to drown in a very unfortunate incident. And I think this is just one of many incidents that we've seen, not only off the shores of Australia, but also, for example, in the Mediterranean. High levels of state expenditure has been another negative outcome, and I think, again, you'll be more familiar with this than I am. I've seen some of the figures cited for the amount of money that Australia is spending on offshore processing, and it's absolutely astronomical. And I think the deterrence measures taken by other states elsewhere in the world are also extremely high. And then finally, I would suggest that the deterrence and enforcement agenda that has been imposed in recent years has actually, as our global trends report suggests, created increased regional imbalances, in the sense that a growing proportion of the world's refugees, currently at least 80%, are to be found in the poorest countries of the world, and only 20% are to be found in the industrialized states. And it's my firm belief that the deterrence and enforcement agenda has actually helped to exacerbate these regional imbalances. Before I come on to my last slide, I'd just like to give a quick acknowledgement to my colleague Rick Towell, the regional representative for UNHCR in Canberra, covering not only Australia but neighbouring countries. And I think Rick and his team of people in Canberra have put out some very powerful press releases in recent months, drawing attention to the human and social costs of the deterrence and enforcement agenda. And I can just read some of the headlines. UNHCR finds significant legal and operational inadequacies at Manus Island. Humanitarian response to asylum seekers is needed, says UNHCR. New excision law does not relieve Australia of its international responsibilities, says UNHCR. And then a couple of quotes from somebody you may know, Erica Feller, who recently retired as Assistant High Commissioner for Refugees for Protection, an Australian citizen herself. She put out a statement saying, senior UNHCR official criticises the not-on-my-doorstop attitude towards refugees. And then in a recent speech, she said, unilateral action by individual states doesn't work. Pushing off boats simply deflects the burden to their neighbours and places already vulnerable people in even greater harm's way. She continues, while smuggling and trafficking are criminal acts, responses limited to punitive measures for people affected are simply ineffective. So I think UNHCR has been quite upfront in drawing attention to the very negative consequences of the so-called deterrence and enforcement agenda that I described earlier in my presentation. Okay, that's the bad news. Is there any good news? Well, I think there are some elements that we can add together to create an alternative and more positive strategy in relation to asylum and refugee protection. I'm not pretending there are any easy answers to this. There are some very difficult problems to be resolved, but I think we've now reached a stage where we can present a number of different ways in which a more positive approach to asylum could indeed be pursued. And this is my final slide. I'll quickly run through what I consider to be some of the key components of an alternative strategy towards asylum and refugee protection. Firstly, I think we have to try and understand public concern about the arrival of asylum seekers. I think it's very easy for those of us in the humanitarian and refugee protection world to just simply dismiss public concerns and say these people are racist, they're xenophobes, etc., and not to really understand them. I think there are some genuine causes for concern amongst the public, and I think an alternative strategy has to be based on a very profound understanding of what exactly those concerns are and how they've arisen in recent years. My second suggestion would be that we have to, and I'm using rather extravagant language here, we have to extol asylum achievements. I think those of us in the humanitarian refugee protection community have perhaps been a little bit too defensive in our attitude. We've called on states to respect the principles of refugee protection in the 1951 Convention, for example. I don't think we've done too much to actually say what asylum has achieved over the years, the number of people that it's given protection to, the number of people whose lives it's saved, the number of people whose children are able to enjoy a much better future than would otherwise have been the case. So I think any new strategy that we produce must be based on an effort to actually extol the asylum, the achievements of asylum over the years. At the same time, I do think that we need to insist on states that they should respect obligations that they have freely undertaken. If you read the statements of some politicians, not only here in Australia, but in other parts of the global north, you would imagine that the 1951 Refugee Convention, for example, had been hoisted upon states by UNHCR or been drafted by Amnesty International. As we all know, it wasn't. It's a state-led convention. And we think the least we can expect is for states who have actually established a convention and signed up to its provisions should actually respect those provisions. Unfortunately, that is not always the case at the moment. And I think if we are to insist on states respecting their obligations, that should lead to two very direct consequences. Firstly, I personally believe that states which are undertaking or considering offshore processing arrangements should reconsider those. I don't think there's a place for offshore processing in an effective and equitable strategy to asylum and refugees. And similarly, I think we have to find alternatives to detention. It's simply unconscionable that people are being locked up for months, or if not years on end, without any proof of them engaging in criminal activities whatsoever. And I was interested this morning when I checked my emails to see that UNHCR has just signed a new agreement, a partnership agreement, with the International Detention Coalition. And certainly it's a key policy priority for UNHCR at the moment to try and persuade states that it is indeed possible to find alternatives to detention. I think something else we need to do, and we need to go on the offensive on this a little bit, I think, is to refute the whole notion that refugee movements can be nicely and neatly managed. And again, Rick Towell has been particularly eloquent in this in a number of speeches and press statements that he's given, trying to point out that refugee movements will never be orderly and predictable. By their very nature, as we saw from the crises that I mentioned in the developing world, they're by nature very volatile and very unpredictable, and we just simply have to learn to live with that. So the whole notion that refugee movements can be neatly managed, I think, is one that we have to strongly refute. At the same time, we should not turn our backs on orderly and organised forms of movement. And in that context, I think there is a great need to promote refugee resettlement. I think refugee resettlement has at least three virtues. Firstly, it provides protection to the people who are most in need of it. Secondly, it reduces the pressures that are being placed on countries of first asylum and shows and acts as a kind of gesture of international solidarity and cooperation. But thirdly, I think resettlement can also have some very positive economic outcomes. And I think many of you in the room will be familiar with the work of Professor Graham Hugo here in Adelaide, a report he published, commissioned by the government of Australia a couple of years ago, which shows that the long-term economic outcomes of resettled refugees are actually, and contrary to much public opinion, are actually rather positive. So I think we can promote resettlement, pointing out that it's a key tool of protection, that it reduces the burden on first asylum countries, but that it also can have positive economic consequences for resettlement countries such as Australia. a new idea, the next point on the slide, a new idea is we're doing some thinking within UNHCR as to whether we could explore labour mobility opportunities for refugees. In other words, enable refugees to move from one country to another, not through resettlement programmes, but through labour migration schemes. There may be some, if only a small number, of refugees that have skills and qualifications that are needed in other parts of the world. We're looking into the possibility as to whether we could actually establish programmes which would enable them to take use or, and take advantage of such opportunities. My next point is perhaps a slightly more controversial one, and it's an issue that we've been looking at in UNHCR in depth, some depth in the last few months, which is I think that we should engage with assisted return programmes. As some of you will know, a number of countries, including Australia, I think, have established programmes which allow rejected asylum seekers to go back to their country of origin, usually supported with some kind of reintegration grant, either in cash or in kind. And these are usually referred to by governments as assisted voluntary return programmes. Now, personally, I think we should drop the word voluntary. I think it's a rather disingenuous to use the word voluntary when people are opting to go back to their own country because they're destitute or because they're in detention. But I do think that if we are to preserve the integrity of asylum systems, then we have to come up with answers as to what happens to the rejected cases. Because the fact that the vast majority of rejected asylum seekers in many countries, including my own, the UK, don't actually leave the country but remain in an irregular status, does nothing to actually bolster public or political confidence in the institution of asylum. So I think we as refugee protection people and experts have to really engage with this notion of what happens to people whose asylum applications have been rejected after a full and fair examination of their case, and I'd like to suggest that assisted return programmes could play quite an important role in that respect. And then finally, my suggestion would be, and I've already mentioned this briefly before, that I think we have to try and provide additional support to the first asylum countries, those countries in the developing world and in the middle-income world, which host by far the largest proportion of the world's refugees. As I mentioned a few moments ago, I was recently in Jordan, Lebanon, and Iraq. What you see there is the arrival of massive numbers of Syrian refugees, placing enormous social pressure on those societies, placing enormous economic pressure on those host countries, placing great deal of pressure on the environment and the infrastructure, and in countries of, such as Lebanon, also exacerbating the whole political tensions that exist within that country to a situation where it's now being said that the refugee crisis in Lebanon could actually trigger a whole-scale political crisis. So let me just end by saying that I think we do need to take a look at the systems and procedures that we use ourselves to examine asylum applications and to ensure protection for those who need it. At the same time, there's an overwhelming need for us to give greater support to those countries where the largest number of refugees are currently to be found. And with that, I will thank you very much.